This week on Vaticano, Pope Francis meets with seminarians and encourages them to see their community as imitating the life of the Holy Family. We speak with Cardinal Peter Erdo, Primate of Hungary, as he prepares to host this year's International Eucharistic Congress in September. And meet Irene Gaeta, one of Padre Pio's spiritual children, who has dedicated her life to continuing the charitable work of Padre Pio. For this and more, Vaticano starts now. Pope Francis met with seminarians from the Pius XI Pontifical Seminary in Italy's Marche region, asking them to see seminary life as mirroring the life of the Holy Family in Nazareth.
The Son of God accepted to let himself be loved and guided by human parents, Mary and Joseph, teaching each of us that without docility, no one can grow and mature.
The Holy Father spoke on the four dimensions of formation: human, spiritual, intellectual, and pastoral. As future priests, Pope Francis encouraged the seminarians to remain close to the people and see their prayer lives as an opportunity to grow closer to God. Pope Francis met with United European Football Academy president Alexander Seferin and Italian Soccer Federation President Gabriele Gravina on the eve of the European Soccer Championships opener between Turkey and Italy. The Holy Father blessed the team ahead of the tournament in the Olympic Stadium in Rome. Each member of the Academy received a copy of Pope Francis' letter, Sports According to Pope Francis, an open letter to an Olympic athlete.
Queridos hermanos y hermanas,
the Holy Father sent a video message to the Latin American Federation of Jesuit Schools, congratulating them on their 20th anniversary. This federation is a group of Jesuit schools that work to fulfill the mission of advocating for the Ignatian model in all the organizations of the federation.
I would like schools to be welcoming schools, or rather places where one's own and others' wounds can be healed. Schools where the doors are truly open, and not only in the words, where the poor can enter, and where one can go to meet the poor. They embody the wisdom of the gospel, which is the privileged perspective from which we can learn so much.
The Holy Father wanted to stress the importance of schools and educators imbuing virtue and forming the consciences of future missionaries and disciples within the Church. Years have passed since the death of Saint Jose Maria Escrivá, founder of Opus Dei, the work of God. Known as the Saint of Ordinary Life, Saint Jose Maria opened up a new path to sanctification in the Catholic Church, reminding us that all men can achieve holiness by doing their work, living their everyday lives with a Christian spirit. The second of six children, Jose Maria was born on January the 9th, 1902, in Barbastro, a small Spanish town in the province of Huesca. His father, Jose Escrivá, was a cloth merchant, while his mother, Dolores, did the housework. He received a solid and profound Christian education from his parents. As a child, Jose Maria had to face a series of difficult trials: the death of three sisters at an early age, and the economic crisis of his father's business. These events led the Escrivá family to move to Logroño in 1915. It was in this city that José María first perceived his vocation to the priesthood. This vocation matured in 1918 when he began his ecclesiastical studies in the seminary of Logroño. He completed his studies in the seminary of San Francisco de Paul in Zaragoza, where he was ordained a priest on March the 28th, 1925. In 1927, with the bishop's permission, he moved to Madrid to pursue a doctorate in law. And it was in the Spanish capital that on October the 2nd, 1928, God showed him his mission, the universal call to holiness in ordinary life and work. On that day, the work of God was born, which, translated into Latin, will always remain Opus Dei.
En la fiesta de los santos ángeles custodios, el 2 de octubre de 1928, quiso el Señor que apareciera el Opus Dei. Una movilización de cristianos que supieran sacrificarse gustosos por los demás, que hicieran divinos los caminos humanos de la tierra, todos, santificando cualquier trabajo noble, cualquier trabajo limpio, cualquier quehacer terreno.
José María Escrivá was in Madrid when civil war broke out in 1936. Religious persecution forced him to take refuge in various places, exercising his priestly ministry clandestinely until he was able to leave Madrid. After crossing the Pyrenees, he settled temporarily in Burgos. After the war in 1939, he returned to the capital where he preached numerous spiritual exercises for lay people, priests, and religious. In 1946, he settled definitively in Rome, obtaining a doctorate in theology from the Lateran University. From Rome, he traveled several times to different European countries to give impetus to the start and consolidation of Opus Dei's apostolic activities. Saint José María died on June the 26th, 1975, and his body rests in the Prelate's Church of Santa Maria della Pace in Rome. On May the 17th, 1992, John Paul II beatified José María Escrivá de Balaguer. 10 years later, on October the 6th, 2002, he proclaimed him a saint in St. Peter's Square, packed with people. This week, Joe Biden made his first international trip as President of the United States to attend the US-EU summit on June the 15th. For the occasion, the Commission of the Bishops' Conferences of the European Community and the United States Bishops' Conference signed a joint declaration to encourage policymakers to build a stronger working relationship that is at the service of a more just, peaceful, and sustainable world. The declaration states that the US and the EU can be beacons of trust across the global community and engines for a reinvigoration of multilateral cooperation. Cardinal Jean-Claude Hollerich, president of the European Bishops' Conference, also known as COMECE, said it's important that politicians see that American and European Catholics are united.
And of course, we care for politics, not because we want to mix in politics, but for more equal, for more justice, for more peace, and so on. So it's good that the churches say something. And the United States of America and the European Union represent the same Western world. So values like democracy, freedom, justice, human rights, and so on.
Cardinal Hollerich says that today multilateralism is the biggest challenge, but it is also what is lacking the most between nations.
I hope that politicians understand that Christians have a stance in politics, and that it's good to listen to the representatives of the churches, that we know also about the problems they have to face, and that we are on their side if they look for solutions.
The European Bishops' Conference was created 40 years ago in Brussels, Belgium, with the aim of making the Catholic Church present in Europe. Every year, a delegation from Comece travels to Rome to meet with Pope Francis and high officials of the Holy See. The Vatican's contributions to international discussions are growing. On June the 1st, the United Nations World Health Organization granted the Holy See non-member state observer status. This new status means that the Holy See will be permitted to observe sessions and participate in debates. However, it will not be allowed to vote on issues or put forth candidates. In an interview with EWTN United Nations correspondent Christian Peshkin, then permanent observer to the United Nations in Geneva, Archbishop Ivan Jurkovic, said that for several years the Holy See intended to be a state observer to the UN World Health Organization.
Because if you are not institutionally present in the international organizations, they do not understand you properly. So people understood the Holy See like a humanitarian organization, you know, not as a internationally recognized sovereign entity, juridical entity. We are here presented as a sovereign juridical entity, not as an NGO. No?
Archbishop Jurkovic says that the Holy See decided to become a permanent observer to the WHO because of Pope Francis' strong support for multilateralism, and with the intention that the Holy See will contribute in helping to tackle the pandemic. After the break, we speak with Cardinal Peter Erdo about the upcoming Eucharistic Congress in Hungary. The International Eucharistic Congress in Budapest is going to be celebrated in less than 2 months. The global pandemic forced the Congress to be postponed from September of 2020 to September of 2021. The Primate of Hungary, Cardinal Peter Erdo, says that despite this change, many people maintain their registration from last year, and there are many new ones.
Adesso siamo a un buon punto. Vuol dire che...
Now we are at a good point, meaning that 2,000 to 3,000 are registered for each day of the week, while for the bigger gatherings in Heroes Square, the mass in front of Parliament, and for the procession, there are already tens of thousands of faithful that want to participate and register.
According to the press release of the Hungarian Bishops' Conference, Pope Francis is expected to arrive in Hungary for the September the 12th closing mass, and spend a day in Budapest, meeting the religious and political leaders, including Prime Minister Viktor Orban and President of the Republic, Adr Janos.
Sicuramente non si tratta di un viaggio diplomatico.
This is certainly not a diplomatic trip, nor a major pastoral visit, but it's that he personally accepted to celebrate the Statio Orbis for the whole world. And we certainly feel honored because it's not every Eucharistic Congress that the Pope personally comes. And this time, he wanted to come and accepted our invitation.
Cardinal Peter Erdo says that the preparations for the International Eucharistic Congress are twofold, the organizational one and the spiritual one. Hungary started its spiritual preparations 4 years ago. In 2017, the Holy Father blessed the missionary cross, which contains a relic of the true cross and others of some local saints.
La croce missionaria che attraversava tutto il bacino dei Carpazi.
The cross crossed the entire Carpathian Basin, and not only the Hungarian cities, but also the nearby countries. The cross has already visited Slovakia, a part of the Ukraine, Romania, Serbia, and Croatia. So there is general interest.
C'è un interesse generale.
There are relics not only of Hungarian saints, but also from neighboring countries. This cross symbolizes unity in faith. The Cardinal says that the hymn of the 52nd Eucharistic Congress also denotes a message of unity, and it contains the lyrics from the previous Eucharistic Congress in Budapest in
1938.
The hymn of the Eucharistic Congress in 1938 already had an interesting prehistory. The final verses always asks Christ to reunite people in peace, and this in 1938 is also very cognizant of very real things, up to the point that Hitler banned citizens of the Third Reich, that is Germany, to come and participate in the Congress. And so they understood the meaning of the prayer, but they did not agree with this. In the end, the Bishops' Conference preferred to keep the hymn's text, because this union in charity around Christ of all people and in peace is a very timely thought.
E in pace è un pensiero tuttora attuale.
The main focus of the Eucharistic Congress will be the sacrament of the Eucharist. The program includes time for prayer, different sessions, testimonials, and cultural programs. The Congress will start on September the 5th with the opening mass at Heroes Square. Cardinal Erdo says that there will be roughly 1,500 children who will receive First Communion during the opening Mass. When we return, we learn how St. Padre Pio's mission of love to the needy continues today through one of his spiritual daughters.
Just over 20 kilometers from Rome, Ereni Gaeta and the disciples of the Padre Pio Association work in the footsteps of Saint Padre Pio, caring for the poor, the needy, and the suffering. Ereni Gaeta is one of the many spiritual children of Padre Pio. However, unlike his other children, Ereni claims that she first met Padre Pio spiritually, years before they would meet physically.
Let me begin by asking you to go back to the start. Where were you born? Where did you grow up?
I come from a very, very religious family. When I was 9 years old, I prayed and made many little sacrifices. Then I read about Saint Gemma Golgana and Saint Maria Goretti, and these teachings of the saints instilled in me the desire to die for the Lord, to give him my whole life, at a certain point to accompany Jesus who had died for me, and I wanted to die for him.
Something remarkable happened when you were 9 years of age.
On June
18th, 1946, I was going to bed that night when I saw a lot of light in my room. I couldn't see my brother's bed or mine, which were very close to me, but I saw an altar where Padre Pio blessed me with a monstrance. But when he blessed me, his eye through the monstrance was like a sharp blade within my soul, and he didn't say anything to me. Then I said to him, "Who are you?" And he said to me, "I am Padre Pio of Pietrelcina." I asked a second time, "Who are you?" "I am Padre Pio of Pietrelcina." And a third time, "Who are you?" He became angry and said, "I am a friar that prays, and one day you will know who I am." And so I said to him, "But I don't know you." And he said to me, "But I know you, because since you were born, the Eternal Father entrusted you into my hands."
From that moment on, Irini says that Padre Pio became a spiritual father to her, appearing 2 to 3 times a week for 11 years. During this time, Padre Pio was alive and living 400 kilometers to the south in San Giovanni Rotondo.
And when did you realize that the person you were seeing all these years was in actual fact Padre Pio?
I noticed when I was 20 years old when I bought the Italian daily newspaper. In this newspaper there was a small picture of Padre Pio, very small, like 2 inches by 2 inches, no bigger. The first time that I saw him, it was like he came out from the newspaper, hitting me right in the eyes, no? And I said, "Mom, Mom, this is the friar that I always see." I read that he was Padre Pio of Pietrelcina, but then I didn't see Padre Pio anymore. So from that time that I discovered that he really existed, that he was alive, I no longer saw him.
The first time you met Padre Pio in person, what do you remember from that? What was it like?
He told me, "Finally, my daughter, you have come. I've been waiting for you." But then Padre Pio continued to speak with me when I went to him for confession. But Padre Pio, the confession was only confession. We didn't speak about anything else, but only if the Lord, the Eternal Father, might have told him to give me something very specific. And I always spoke with Padre Pio during the Mass. While celebrating Mass, he would speak to me, and he often appeared to me. He had 3 dimensions, you know?
Irini, tell us where we are now and the significance of this center, this house that you have here.
One day, Padre Pio told me, "My daughter, there will be much solitude. And remember that leprosy can be cured with medicine, but loneliness only with love." He said to me, "Get a house, open a home to welcome people."
This house in Vetina was just the beginning of the Disciples of Padre Pio's mission of charity and service. Soon, Irini opened other homes for men, women, and children in other parts of the country.
Irini, down in Calabria, as we sit here, they are building a hospital. How did this come about, the hospital?
I am not from Calabria, but one day in my room in 1994, he told me, "In 2004, my daughter, in Calabria, you must make a sanctuary, a pediatric hospital, a research center, and a place for those who are suffering. The land cost 2,080,000 euro. With my association, with the money that my husband bought from his property, we paid for all of it."
We abbiamo pagato tutto.
We placed the first stone on May 28, 2018, and we hope to inaugurate it in the spring of this year, welcoming the children. I must say that already, just days ago, some people have called because they thought we were already welcoming people, because there are so many children that are born with cancer from within their mother's womb.
Finally, what are your hopes and dreams for the future of the hospital?
That land we bought, around 40 acres, we made the first hospice house, now hosting 37 children, which is not so big, but when you see it, it's wonderful. Then there is already the project to make a bigger hospital with 289 beds, an emergency room. Then there is another important project. We have children in Taranto, already being born with cancer, so we have another hospital, a home to accommodate these children, around 95 places. There is enough food for 4,500 meals. Then the land we have already taken, we have the project to make a scientific high school for agriculture. Then there is the research center, so this project is very big. So it is not a hope, but when Padre Pio says something, I do it. I have the certainty that soon it will be accomplished, but of course it takes many millions of euros. And so we hope that the Holy Spirit will provide, as he always has.
Irini, it was lovely meeting you, and thank you so much for your time.
It is I who should thank you.